Good morning, everyone. Welcome back to the Cathedral of St. John Berkman's. Today, Dr. Cheryl White and I would like to get everyone ready for next week. Barry Schwartz will be here. He was the official photographer of the Shroud of Turin Research Project 40 years ago in 1978. You may recall in October of that particular year, he and a number of other people with unbelievably massive machinery flown from the United States to Turin, Italy, began this research on and many different facets of for example, infrared and ultraviolet and all sorts of non-invasive studies on the shroud. They had it for 5 days, five solid days, 120 hours nonstop, in which they were able to do all their experiments and take that research back home. And now hundreds of thousands of hours have been spent specifically on the research that they did. And Barry Schwartz was awake for 5 days, except for 8 hours. He said he could sleep later, but because he would not have such an opportunity to be with the Shroud of Turin. And remember, this is a person who was Jewish and is Jewish. Now, I'm not going to take too much away from his story, but I will say this. He went over there thinking, first of all, he didn't want to do it. He's like, why on earth do I, you know? He humbly admits that there were plenty of other people who are more qualified, certainly faith-filled, but he was truly expert, is expert in his field, and was chosen. Finally, he said, great, you know, free ride to Italy, you know, I'll go. And within 10 minutes, no doubt, I'll be able to see that this is a forgery and see the brush strokes and the dyes and the pigments. And obviously, he was unable to do so. And he, like many other scientists, who are not Catholic, who are not Christian, why on earth are scientists still to this day interested in this 14 and a half foot piece of cloth? Scientists, atheists, agnostics, still interested. Why? Because no one can figure out how this image got onto this cloth. No one can figure it out. Science cannot figure it out. And all the little things that are hidden in there were things that people back 2,000 years ago would not have known what how to do and to put it on there. And certainly people in the Middle Ages, 1200s, 1300s, would have had no clue what to do. This cannot be duplicated even today. It has been tried. Yes, sometimes people will get an image, a faint image on the cloth, but then all of a sudden they're not able to replicate the 3D code that is in this particular, or it always has some type of a shadow because the light that they used, or the ultraviolet shows that, wait, these are burn marks, and this is not a burn mark. So there's some scientists still to this day are unbelievably bewildered, perplexed. They still can't figure it out. Today we want to talk a little bit, yes, on the level of science, but also obviously on the level of faith. But the goal here today is to really get us ready for this internationally known speaker who is coming here. I was with a group of priests in Dallas like 3 weeks ago, and this priest in Richardson, a much larger parish than ours, said, what do you mean you got Barry Schwartz? We've been trying to get him for years. And y'all, yeah, it's like, yeah, you know. We got him. He's coming here. It should be great. And by the way, the podcasts are going very well. It's pretty, I mean, it's gotten some great publicity. People around the country and, in fact, the world, especially some people in Spain, but especially Italy. Anyhow, so we want to talk about the Shroud in order to prepare us for Barry Schwartz's visit. Now, it's just the quickest of reminders. Hopefully, it's already in your calendar. On Friday, he's going to be here. He's going to speak to our Loyola kids. He has an hour with them in the gym with the two projecting screens because he needs his audio visual. And he knows how to do this. He was just in Virginia or something with a group. And he's going to speak to our grade school kids. So I will also be preparing them this upcoming week so that they know all the basics about the shroud. But anyways, I said a lot more than I wanted to before our opening prayer. Let's go ahead and have our opening prayer. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the grace and blessing of this day. And we know that you want to work in our hearts so that we may understand more deeply the love of Jesus who died on the cross for us. Help us to not only understand with our minds, but to love with our hearts. And we know that this we cannot do without the help of your Holy Spirit. And so we beg you to pour out upon us your grace so that we not be overcome or overwhelmed with fear, but let the sufferings of our Lord Jesus Christ help us to imitate more truly that which is divine love. We ask this through the same Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. So, a number of you were able to kind of get a quick look at what we have up here. You get the sneak peek. You know, we still have plenty of other things that we have as a part of the exhibit. But let me just start with this particular model right here. Actually, it's kind of heavy, weighty. It feels very strange to hold this model because it is a representation of our Lord, obviously. And how he would have looked in the tomb based on the information that we have in the shroud. So here's how, and you can see how his knees are kind of up like this, and his head is even forward. Yes, even in the tomb, his body having been placed in the tomb, his head would have still been up. He was on the cross. He was on the cross for hours. And even after he died, he was on the cross. Remember, they had to go to Pontius Pilate. They had to petition him. He's already dead. Please let us have his body. That didn't just happen in 5 minutes' time. Rigor mortis sets in and pretty rapidly. And so here it is. And according to the shroud, this is what his body would have looked like, the position of his hands, etc. I have a personal favorite right here. And it shows Jesus at the foot of the cross with Mary and John. This is from the Rovere family in what? 1575, thank you. So the shroud on the bottom and then the angels up top holding the shroud, the representation of which we have right here. And then, of course, the photo negative. So at a certain point, well, pilgrims down through the ages would come, would look, would see this. They, you know, what is it really? It's kind of hard to tell. You can see kind of an image. You can't get too close. You can't be too far away. They're told that this is the burial cloth of Jesus Christ. And what do? They get on their knees. They pray. They look. They don't understand. There's no science that they're really into at this point. They're told it is the relic, that it is indeed the burial cloth. They believe. That's it. No questions asked. And remember, the cloth ultimately ends up in the hands of the Savoy family, as in the family that ended up becoming the kings of Italy. And especially in 1871, when Italy was united, remember, it was a whole bunch of kingdoms before that. And so Umberto, in 1898, the family, the Savoy family, they have it, and it's in Turin, and they have this royal wedding. And, you know, you got a royal wedding, got a lot of people coming over, kings and queens and others, and we've got the shroud. So what are you going to do? You're going to show it off. And they pulled it out, you know, add a little pomp and circumstance to the whole wedding. And photography had just been discovered, what, about 40 years before that? mid-1800s. And this young man, an amateur photographer, unlike Barry Schwartz, a professional, this young man asks for and gets permission to take a picture. And he takes a picture, and of course, what ends up happening is he gets an image like this, and of course, the close-up of the face, and it had never been seen in this negative form. And so, all of a sudden, it raises, I mean, the hopes, the interest, the science, the everything about it, and the skepticism, because there are plenty of people who said, no, this is a hoax. This can't be. Because ultimately, what we see here is, when you develop a picture back then, like you really had to develop it, and the glass plates, he goes into the dark room, he takes a look at it, and he has the photo negative, and then ultimately they realize that this photo negative is a negative of a negative, that the image of Jesus on the cloth is itself a negative, and so the negative of a negative, it's the positive image. Now you can see the image of Christ far more clearly. And as soon as you put a shroud over it, the shroud acts as a mirror. You know, when you look at yourself in the mirror and you hold your right hand up, it looks like you're holding your left hand up. Well, the shroud acts as a mirror. It's on top of it. So there are ways in which you'll be able, we'll talk about how to tell whether you're looking at the shroud as it is actually, all right, I'm talking about it. So like right there on the forehead, the blood that is right there. You see what looks like, well, here it kind of looks like an M. When you're looking at it straight up and down, it looks like a backwards 3, all right? So you see a backwards 3, that's the mirror image, because this shroud, this picture is taken of the shroud itself, as it would look to us. But that's the mirror image. So if you see something that actually looks like the number 3, you know that you're looking at Jesus. So it would have been flipped. It would be as if you're standing looking at him himself. A few other things that we have here as well, and then it'll be Dr. White's opportunity to come up here, is a flagrum, all right? A flagrum, a whip. There are many different types of whips, by the way. There are some that where they don't have these balls here, they have vertebrae, where you tie vertebrae of sheep, for example, on there. And it's kind of like Mel Gibson's, when they would flip that and it just kind of pulled back and it would rip away at the flesh. According to the shroud, that was not the type of flagrum that was used. It was one that was very much like this, with the two balls, steel balls like that, that kind of looked like dumbbells. And the way in which, and at some point, Barry Schwartz will be able to talk a little bit more about it, especially when we have a really great image of his back and the scourging, we can see those. Everywhere he would have been hit, it would have been a double steel dumbbell marking. And with the science behind it, they can tell that when Jesus was standing and was being scourged, they can basically figure out the height of the person on this side, because every time it was finally level with his back, the two dumbbells would kind of line up here. When they scourged the top part of his body, it would be at an angle. When they scourged his calves, it would have been at a different angle. It would have kind of been fanned like this. But the other thing is that it would have also been a fan pattern like this, because it's clear that there's two people. It's clear that they were of different heights. Their arm lengths would have had to have been different by the what we can read in the shroud itself. Apparently, there were 120 lashes. 120. But with three ropes. So there are discernible approximately 360 lashes. Now you may think to yourself, no, wait a minute. Scripture says, St. Paul himself says that he was scourged any number of times, and he, and it said that you couldn't be scourged but 40 minus one times. Now that was the Jewish law. It wasn't the Jews who scourged our Lord. This was Roman. There was no such limitation. They wanted to inflict maximum pain and humiliation. And of course, since I'm talking about the scourging, remember Pilate didn't want him dead. He says, I can't find anything. Okay, look, y'all are thirsting for his blood. All right. Go ahead and scourge him. So that was the penalty to his crime. Obviously, he ended up with a double penalty, double double jeopardy, which is not, for one crime, you don't get two sentences, but he certainly did. So here it is crystal clear. And by the way, the scourging was head to toe. And I talked about his back. The scourging is across his front. Well, here I am touching my heart. This is about the only area that wasn't scourged. The Romans were experts at this. They knew what to... The point wasn't to kill the person being scourged, so you don't hit the chest area. You don't try to inflict a wound so that the person is going to go into cardiac arrest. And there's nothing on his face either. The back of his neck, all the way down. And yeah, I mean, let me just tell it like it was. The shroud says clearly that his pelvic region was scourged. And it is at the same intensity as the other area, so therefore, it's crystal clear, he would have been naked at the time. Now, of course, on the cross, he would have been naked. We know that. Scripture says it. Again, public humiliation. So anyone else who would see this, okay, you don't want to be like this person, so don't do this. Don't go against the Romans. And even with the scourging. So what took place was horrific. It was meant to be the crime, and that's it. Okay, the Jews' lust for their hunger for blood is now going to be satisfied, but we know that that wasn't the case. They still said, crucify him, crucify him. He pretends to be the king of the Jews. Oh, he's a king. So let's make sure that this king has a crown. Okay, where else in the Bible is a person mentioned as having been crowned with thorns? Old Testament or New? Anyone?
Zilch.
Nowhere. Okay, what about in anywhere else in any type of literature, in any type of anything, anywhere? There is no recorded record, nothing passed down by word of mouth of anyone else having been crowned with thorns. And by crown, we mean that the shroud says that it would not have been a headband of thorns, but a cap of thorns, a helmet of thorns. And so it may sound strange to us, but if you go back in that day and age and you look at the artwork of a number of the kings and queens and other people, they at times would have their crown would not have been just been a headband. It would have been a helmet. It would have it might have even had a number of strips on top with a bunch of different jewels on top, whatever. This would have been the type of crown that they knew about. And then the shroud tells us that this person received, well, that the crown would have pierced into the head 50 to 70 times. And that oftentimes we think of like a thorn bush. I mean, this is great. This offers us a very, and actually it says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, today's gospel reading. So very providential, but the thorns themselves would have probably been about 3/4 of an inch long, maybe a little bit longer. Any of the thorns, now again, this shows more of the band and not the cap, but it certainly gives you the visual of it being placed upon his head. And the capillaries, it's the most sensitive area of the body, and you cut there, it's going to bleed more quickly, profusely, and most likely those 50 to 70 thorn marks would have gone to the skull. It's not just a little prick of the skin. It's going to the bone plate itself. The shroud tells us that the one particular area of the blood it comes from the artery. All right, but another part it comes from the vein. Science today can tell you that this is arterial blood or it is venal blood. Am I saying that right? Thank you. Venal blood. So science can tell us. And sure enough, it corresponds with what is discovered. So, by the way, had someone 2,000 years ago or in the 1300s thought to themselves, okay, well, we're going to make this forgery in such a way that no other forgery is going to be done. Okay, let's make sure, let's get some frontal arterial blood, and now let's get some of the venal blood. Let's make sure it's in all the right spots. By the way, they didn't know about all that stuff back then, obviously. So here's yet again another clear example of what the shroud tells us about the crucifixion. Speaking of blood, they can now do the test, and it's AB. It's AB. You know, about 3% of the population has AB blood. It is human. Originally, they weren't able to tell, but now they have the equipment to tell. There's one Italian who really wants to get in and get another sample, a good sample of the blood, because the technology is so different than in 1978. No, we're not able to figure out the genome, the DNA of the blood, but we can tell it's human, we can tell it's male, we can tell it's AB. There's so many different things like this that we can talk about. With regards to a number of the other wounds, and that's why part of the prayer that I offered was, may we not be too horrified by what we learn regarding the man of the shroud, because the torture was unbelievably overwhelming. The nail prints say that the crucifixion would have taken place, that he would have been nailed to the cross through what we would say the wrist area, because it also very clearly shows the blood and how it flows out from the wrist, and how it would have hit this nerve, the particular median nerve, the ulnar nerves that are right there, which either would have snapped or would have rubbed up against. And apparently this is like one of the most absolute painful nerves to hurt. People who are injured in war, right there, World War I, World War II, that there are accounts that they're injured there, they can't get morphine, that they're saying, put me out of my misery. With a wound, if you get shot right there or, and he's on the cross, and every time he has to move, it's rubbing up against that nerve. It's sending shockwaves, lightning bolts of pain. In fact, one of the people doing all the forensic evidence of the man in the shroud says he probably died just of that absolute shock, just the overwhelming shock. I mean, we speak in terms of suffocation, and And that's what most people say he died of, and probably that was indeed what happened. When you're hanging from the cross, when you're down in this position, it's like, of course, when you're breathing, you know, you're in the inhalation position, and to exhale, well, while you're hanging, there's no room in the chest cavity to. So what do you have to do? You're pinned to the cross. You have to pull up on the very, with that nerve, and you're rubbing up against it, and you're kind of twisting to the side in order to get a little bit of place where you can exhale and then inhale. You don't want to do that, but that's the only way that you can keep going. And again, the Romans knew how to inflict maximum pain. And had he not been scourged the way he had been, he might very well have stayed on the cross a lot longer. So he's there, and imagine pushing down on your feet. I mean, not on anything flat, obviously. And so you're pushing down, and you're trying to get another breath. As he is saying all along, I mean, breathing must have been difficult enough, but he's talking. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they are doing. You know, the word there, I mean, we always say, and he said, but in the Greek, it's actually, and he was saying. So might that have been a little mantra of his? You know, and he was saying, Father, forgive them, Father, forgive them. And of course, you know, I thirst, and then behold your mother, behold your son, and then it is finished. Actually, I skipped one. My God, why have you abandoned me? So just even the talking. So I haven't even scratched the surface of all the pain that was endured. And we're not even talking about the pain of just the mockery. I mean, he was mocked as being a king. You know, put the purple cloak on. So have you ever had a Band-Aid and just kind of ripped it off and just, ow, my goodness, ah. Well, they put a cloak on a scourged body and then took it off. I'm sure it wasn't just nice and calm. Okay, hey, let's not hurt him. No, you know, rip. I mean, so everything, again, the Romans were experts at torture. They knew exactly what they were doing. They knew how to inflict the maximum pain, maximum humiliation, and that's what the shroud clearly tells us. There are a lot of other things that I might say at the end, but Barry Schwartz is going to be able to tell us a lot of this in detail, and he continues to teach. He's part of a group in Rome that teaches teachers, you know, gives people who want to receive certification to be able to go out and tell others about the Shroud of Turin. But I relied on all of this as my audio, as my visual, excuse me. Dr. White has a very nice PowerPoint presentation for us and discussion about what we see as well. So, you're up.
You can jump in, right?
Right. By the way, I was supposed to speak for 5 minutes. I just got going. I'm sorry.
I think I'm on here. Hold on just a second.
Is that rector's license?
Yeah, that's the rector's license. Exactly.
Can everybody hear me?
Yes.
Okay. Sounds great.
Good, I am on now. Okay.
There we go.
Please feel free to jump in here anytime you want to, because you can also contribute very much to this. So, yeah, who is the man of the shroud? How many of you have been listening to the podcasts? What's
Thank
wrong
you.
With the rest of you? They are easily accessible on iTunes. You can go into the iTunes store and subscribe. They're completely free. You can also, of course, listen to them through the Cathedral website. We have a WordPress landing page for them. So they're also on YouTube, I understand. So you should be able to get them there, too. A lot of what you hear in the podcast was actually taken from a booklet that was compiled by Dr. John Jackson. If you don't know Dr. John Jackson, you, can we say that? He's coming, maybe? Well, anyway, okay. Dr. John Jackson was...
He is coming.
Okay, I'm going to let him say it. Who is the leading scientist on the 1978 Shroud of Turin research project that we're going to talk a little about in the PowerPoint. So the data that I'm sharing with you is all data that has been peer-reviewed. It has been subjected to pretty rigorous scrutiny from a variety of disciplines. And because, you know, if you get on the internet, you're going to read some weird things about the Shroud of Turin. There's all sorts of inaccurate information out there. So what I think we're endeavoring to do is to bring you that which is there is a great consensus about. Would you think that's fair to say, Father? So, all right. So what is this particular cloth? It says 14 and a half feet long, and you know that because we have a full-size replica on the wall behind us here. 14 and a half foot long. It is, obviously, as Father has talked about extensively, it bears the image of a crucified man. We know that. It has been subjected to absolutely more rigorous scientific examination than any other object in all of history. As a matter of fact, not just scientists have looked at this. Photographers, imaging specialists, historians have a great interest in this cloth. One period in particular that I'll mention to you is of special interest right now. And it also, of course, has been subjected to botany and chemistry and physics, and art historians have looked at it. There's been so many different fields of academic endeavor brought to bear on it. But yet, as much as we know about it, we still realize how much there is that we don't know. Every single question just produces a new question, and so we have lots of mysteries with it still. It still is a mystery in many ways. And this is one thing that I would say right up front, is that any object that is produced in the material world ultimately gives up its secrets. Do you know what I mean by that? Something that man makes or something that is created in the material world ultimately gives up all of its secrets. So the fact that we have studied this extensively, not just really for the last 40 years, but probably beginning, going back a little bit earlier than that, with the 1976 effort we're going to talk about, the fact that we still have questions and the fact that every time we answer a question, there's a new question, tells us that this perhaps could not be of the material world. And I'm just going to introduce that thought to you. Okay, is everybody following my logic on that? All right, so there is a documented historical timeline. And when I say this, I'm talking about an undisputed record. Undisputed meaning that there is no question about what I'm getting ready to tell you. The period before 1355, there are actually two different sort of competing histories about where this cloth might have been up until 1204. We know where it was in 1204. We don't know where it was between 1204 and 1355. And that's the subject of a comment I want to talk about in a minute. So it shows up in the undisputed documented historical record in 1355. It is on display in Liray, France. There's a public expedition. It was in the possession of Geoffrey de Charny, who was a knight who had been engaged in considerable service to the King of France, Jean II, and actually, I believe, ended up dying the following year at the Battle of Poitiers in France during the Hundred Years' War. But we know that it went on display in 1355, so that is in the record. So the next thing we know for certain is that in 1532, the shroud was in Chambéry, France. We know that there was a fire in the church there, and a group of Franciscans rescued the shroud from the fire, and that produces some of the kind of distinguishing characteristics that you see on the cloth itself. Does everybody notice the parallel set of burn marks? It's probably one of the most obvious things you see, is that parallel set of burn marks along the center. Well, that's because we believe the shroud was folded into a metal reliquary, okay? So that perhaps only a portion of it would have been seen through the glass front. And that fold in a metal reliquary, the heat actually produced these scorch marks, these burn marks. The water marks, we believe, were produced by another process, but that's something we can go into later if we have time. Here's what's important about that. In 1532, because of the fire, because of these scorch marks, and because there was damage to the linen, now not to the image, miraculously there was no damage to the image itself, but to the linen, the sister group, sister order, of course, to the Franciscans, the Poor Clares, undertook a repair of the cloth. And there's two ways we think that this was done, perhaps done. One of the things they did was they sewed a reinforcing cloth on the back of it. It's called the Holland cloth because the linen came from Holland. Holland cloth was sewn onto the back to sort of strengthen the linen itself. And they may have, in fact, done a parallel or an internal weave where they actually, think about the tedious nature of this, threading individual threads or fibers into the cloth itself to strengthen it. Why is that important? Maybe you'll see in a few minutes. You'll see why that's important that this cloth repair took place. Okay, so 1578, the shroud was moved for safekeeping to the Cathedral of St. John the Baptist in Turin, Italy, which is where it has been ever since. That's why, of course, we call it the Shroud of Turin, is because it is housed at the cathedral there in Turin. And then the next major event that happens in sort of the documented history of the shroud is what Father Peter's already alluded to, that in 1898 it was photographed by an amateur photographer named Secunda P. It was the first time that the shroud had ever been photographed. And this is what really launches the age of shroud inquiry, is because for the very first time, people were able to see not just what you can see with the naked eye, which is all the medieval pilgrim in 1355 would have been able to see, this faint outline, this faint image of a man. Because of Secunda Pia, as Father mentioned, when he went into his dark room to process his plates, you can imagine being that person in history and seeing for the first time the extent of what was on this cloth that no one had seen before. So I'll show you that in just a minute. 1973, the very first sort of scientific investigations began. Under Pope Paul VI, there were some fiber and pollen samples allowed to be taken that year in 1973. An internationally renowned botanist by the name of Dr. Max Fry did that. And we'll talk about those pollens in just a minute. 1976, this is huge. This is what launches the current age of shroud inquiry, is that NASA had developed a new technology called the VP8 analyzer. It's designed specifically to take like images from the Hubble, for instance. When the Hubble satellite would take photographs and send them back to Earth, they could take these photographs and run them through this analyzer and tell if there was any dimension to these, or what kind of dimension. Because what it does is it reads the differences between the light and the shadow and gives you depth and dimension. And so there was a nuclear physicist working at the time at the Air Force Academy named Dr. John Jackson, who's working very closely with NASA on some nuclear projects, who learned about this analyzer. He's a Catholic, had a great interest in the shroud. So he asked, could we run a photograph of the shroud through this VP8 analyzer? And the results are really stunning. We'll talk about that too. That's another major event, because that is what launches the 1978 Shroud of Research, Shroud of Turin Research Project, which is the only, to date, comprehensive examination of the shroud that has ever been permitted. Everything we know today is pretty much the result of samples that were taken in 1978 during that five-day period that Father Peter already mentioned, that they were given this five-day unprecedented, you can do whatever you want in these hours. So that project, STIRP, you'll hear Barry talk a lot about next week. That was what, sort of the center part, the core of his story, is that began his 40-year journey, is that he was invited to be part of this project and document it photographically. So, as I mentioned, Secunda Pia takes the first photograph, and there it is, of course, in its positive form, Secunda Pia, and this is what he saw in the darkroom. So for the first time, we knew that there was so much more detail on this cloth than anyone had ever seen. Nobody in the Middle Ages had seen this. Nobody in the 19th century had seen this. And coincidentally, of course, 1898, if you read the piece that I just wrote in the Catholic Connection about the devotion to the Holy Face, this is really what launches a new devotion in the church. devotion to the Holy Face, that that now we have this image of the Holy Face. All right, so what do we know about it? What do we know about it today is from this 1978 project. Okay, everything that we know comes from samples taken in 1978. There is a group of scientists, particularly a lot of work being done today as we speak right now, in one particular place in Italy, the University of Padua, is doing a lot of work with the original samples that were taken. As a matter of fact, when Father Peter and I were at this international conference this summer, there was a young man there, Dr. Fonti, who has one of the original fibril samples that they took for blood testing, and we were able to see that under a microscope. Well, you'll get to see it too if you come next week, right? Not it, but you'll get to see a photograph that was taken through the microscope. All right, so this is what happened. I mentioned this earlier. When this photograph of the shroud was run through this VP8 analyzer in 1976, it did something, it produced a result that has never been produced by any other photograph or artwork ever. This particular cloth has a three-dimensional code that is embedded in it. Okay, that means something on a lot of different levels. First of all, it actually covered a human form when the image was made. And that image formation left a three-dimensional code in the cloth itself on the very top fibrils only. It's so superficial that this is incredible. So superficial, only the top fibrils of each fiber. So Father Peter, help me remember now, how many fibers are there and then fibrils, would we say?
Right, so you have a thread.
Right, you have a thread.
And then you have the fibers in the thread, and then there's approximately 200 fibrils per fiber.
Right. So we're talking about an image that is incredibly superficial. And the team that did this were so blown away by the results. And I want to stress to you again, they have run no photograph or any artwork, and this has been tried to be replicated many times with many different images and artworks. This is the only image in the world that bears this kind of three-dimensional information. So that meant that later in the 21st century, computer graphic artists have been able to take that code and extract it and recreate a three-dimensional image of what could be the Holy Face. So this is the thing, that the novelty of this, the realization that there was nothing else quite like this, is really what inspired Dr. Jackson to get together the funding, to put together a team of 26 scientists, to go to Turin, to petition, first of all, to have permission, to have access to it, and to undertake this, as I said, what has been the only comprehensive examination of this cloth that has ever taken place. And this is some pictures of their team. Right down here, and you can't see him very well, but this is Barry. You'll meet him next week. Barry was one of the photographers, but he was the official lead photographer on the project. And this is Dr. John Jackson here. This is Dr. Raymond Rogers. You'll hear me talk about him in just a minute. They're getting the first sort of look right here as the Holland cloth. Remember I talked about the Holland cloth that was on the back. As that was sort of pulled away, they're getting the first look sort of underneath there. So this is where, again, we get all of the information that I'm going to share with you and the data that is primarily agreed upon. So this is what STIRP determined. And go ahead and add STIRP to your vocabulary, because that's just sort of the way that people refer to this project, is by its abbreviated form, STIRP. So we know that it bears the image, as we've sort of obviously said, a man who was scourged and crucified in Roman fashion, a man who was capped with a crown of thorns, who was pierced in the right side of his chest. And I should add, and I think that Father Peter also highlighted this really well, there is only one man in history in whom these unique wounds are documented. It's not like, okay, yes, hundreds and hundreds and hundreds, perhaps thousands of men were crucified under the Roman Empire. We don't have any of their remains to study. We've only found one crucified remain in 1968 that was discovered in an ossuary because the Romans reused their materials and they destroyed the bodies. So we have one man in history who's documented to have not just been crucified and scourged, scourging also not uncommon, but to have been capped with a crown of thorns and to have this unique piercing in the right side. That's not documented in any other man anywhere in history. So we know that forensic pathologists have told us that this man is anatomically correct. If this were an artwork or a painting, this was done with incredible precision because he's anatomically perfect. You know, and even the great masters of the Renaissance got this wrong sometimes. You know that, right? Even the great masters, if you look at works of Michelangelo, you can almost sometimes always find, even though they're beautiful, a little bit of a lack of perspective, precision. We talked about this when we looked at the Pieta, for instance, that Mary is larger than life, right? You want to say something? Jump in.
Well, how normally do they ultimately kill you when you're on the cross? What brings about your death?
Asphyxiation.
What brings about the asphyxiation? Breaking the legs. So they went up and they wanted to break his legs and they're like, well, he's already dead. Of course, the prophecy says not a bone of his body was broken. And we'll talk about that later with regards to the nail prints in his hand, in his wrist. So again, there's only one person who had a spear thrust into his side in the fifth and the sixth ribs. Only one person. So again, it all adds up to only one person in history that we know about. There's no bone discerned to have been broken. About the only thing broken would have been the cartilage on his nose, which they are able to discern. But I just wanted to jump in there with regards to the spear, and that's what makes this unique. You don't find others. They wanted to take his body down from the cross. Now we're outside of science, all right? Now we're back into the area of religion. It was the day of preparation for the Passover. And so he'd already died. And so, okay, let's try to do this as quickly as possible. Let's take his body off of the cross, his naked body off of the cross. And what they would have immediately done was had this cloth to lay the body in, cover it over, tie, you know, some type of a strip probably around the chin and maybe the knee, the ankles. Remember when Jesus says to Lazarus, come forth, he comes out, he's still has his shroud on, but what do they say? Unbind him. There are those claws that kind of still kind of keep the shroud intact on the body, and so anyhow.
Thank you. No, absolutely. Jump in anytime, please. The image on the cloth shows, and you see it on the statue up here too, only the four fingers of each hand, which Father Peter mentioned. The reason we believe that is because in this penetration of the ulnar nerve that would have been caused by a large sharp object would have caused the thumbs to retract. So that the thumbs are not visible on the body, this upward gouge in the right side of the thoracic cavity, we talked about the puncture wounds at the forehead and the nape of the neck, feet pierced with a large object. One of the most distinctive blood flow patterns on the shroud is at the feet, largest collection of blood at the feet. And then he has these 360 plus identifiable wounds. Incidentally, visible only, the intricacies of which are visible only under ultraviolet light. The reason that we know that the flagrum would have had these balls and not the shards, as Father mentioned, is because these match with the wounds of the man in the shroud. Okay, that under ultraviolet light, we were able to see that. Incidentally, a technology not available until the late 19th century. So we know it's blood-stained, of course. There are no paints or pigments of any kind on the cloth. As a matter of fact, the only pigment is human blood. It's the only pigment on the cloth. And here's something that's rather interesting, too. The blood was present on the cloth before the image. So in other words, the man who was wrapped in this shroud bled first. The image was made second. Y'all processing that? Okay. So the blood is there first, the image was created second. The blood on the shroud is human. We knew all of this going back into the 1980s, but what is kind of new is that the University of Texas Health Sciences Center in 2013 were able to say that it was type AB male. We knew it was type AB before. Let's scratch that. We knew it was type AB. We didn't know it was type AB male. This has recently been corroborated by, I mentioned Dr. Giulio Fonti, this has been corroborated by his team at the University of Padua, that it is type AB male. Dr. Fonti believes he has isolated it to specifically type AB negative, which would make it the rarest blood type in the world, but that has not yet been peer reviewed. So I didn't just tell you that, okay? That's not been peer reviewed. There's something else that's not been peer reviewed yet that's kind of exciting, and that is that they believe they have identified some genetic markers that that I think would align perfectly with who we already think the man in the shroud is, right? Of a specific Semitic origin. Okay, so this is really exciting because Dr. Max Fry, who I mentioned in 1973, took the first pollen samples from the shroud using literally like sticky tape, like scotch tape, took several samples and identified 56 different species of plants on the shroud. And of those 56, there are 7 that are unique to the Middle East and 2 that are specific to Jerusalem. So at some point in its history, the cloth had to be in Jerusalem. That's what we know from that. And then, of course, the other samples place it in Constantinople, in Turkey, in the Constantinople area, and also, of course, as you might expect, in France and Italy. So its environmental journey pretty much aligns with what the historical narrative we think is. And the other thing, this could be a whole other subject, and I think it is a subject of a whole other podcast we're doing, but the weave of the cloth itself is so unusual that it is typically cloths of the ancient world were very simple. This points to someone of means having acquired this burial shroud. This was not an ordinary cloth. It's a 3-in-1 herringbone weave, which, as I said, the more complicated the weave, the more expensive the cloth. And so it points to someone of means, someone of wealth, having acquired this linen. And the other thing that is really important about it is that there are many, many people who have studied at length textiles. I can't imagine doing this, but anyway, who have studied textiles from the Middle Ages. We have lots and lots of surviving samples of clothing and tablecloths, for instance, and linens from the Middle Ages, and there is no such weave like this seen in anything medieval, which a textile expert would tell you points to it being older than the Middle Ages. And Father Peter wants to jump in again. Go ahead. Come on.
Well, I didn't know if you were still going to say something about a penniless carpenter, preacher, walking around Judea and makes his way to Jerusalem for the Passover and gets buried in an unbelievably exquisite, great shroud, cloth. Who would have provided that?
Joseph.
Exactly.
Right.
Exactly. So right. So it all matches up with what we know, not what the shroud itself tells us, but what the Bible tells us about the shroud.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. Yes. Okay, so this is kind of new also. There were soil samples that were taken from the shroud, and this was actually part of the original 78 STURP project, and then there was a 2002 project where the Holland backing cloth was taken off, which is a whole other subject, very unfortunate event in history when this happened. But there were soil samples taken then as well from the feet area and from the knees, and it's a particular kind of travertine aragonite, and I don't pretend to know a lot about soil. I can just say the name and sound really official, can't I? Travertine aragonite was found in the shroud, and this is a type of soil. The specific type is found only in the old city of Jerusalem.
Well, and also...
Jump in. Why don't you just stay up here?
Right on the tip of his nose was some soil. Think about carrying the cross, and don't think in terms of the T shape, but what would have been the crossbar, you know, on his back, and we know he fell at least 3 times. You don't have your hands to brace you. you're unbelievably weak, you know, his face would have gone crashing into the ground. There's no doubt about it. And right, so this particular, you know, you get your periodic table out, you put the dirt underneath the microscope, you can figure out what this is made of, and then you look at the crystallization process of this, and in fact, wouldn't you know it, I have a quote here.
Okay.
This particular geologist says about the soil, it quotes the soil of Jerusalem like a fingerprint. This is what a geologist, has nothing to do with being Christian, anything else. It quotes the soil of Jerusalem like a fingerprint. Because it's a rare crystallized structure, and they know right where it came from. In fact, they can still find this particular dirt outside the Damascus Gate, if any of you have been there. And it's not up on top. You have to dig a little bit deeper, and you'll find travertine aragonite.
Yeah, so it's just an accident that it's there, right?
And somehow, yeah.
Some medieval artists knew to get the travertine aragonite in the old city of Jerusalem.
They were smart.
So here's the big sticky widget that everyone always, everyone holds it up as the gold standard, of course, that carbon 14 dating, the cloth was dated in 1988 by a group of Oxford scientists. And the published findings of their carbon 14 dating is that the cloth can be no older than 1290 to about 1360. So we have about a 70-year window in which this cloth was said to have belonged. Now this has been refuted very strongly by Raymond Rogers, the guy who I showed you in the other Sturp photograph. Refuted by Dr. Raymond Rogers, who incidentally, Raymond Rogers was one of the only, I think, one of the major atheists slash agnostics on the team. And so he really didn't have a dog in this fight, so to speak. But he concluded, based on where the sample was taken from, and I know Father Peter wants to talk about this because you're excited. No, you're excited about this. I know you are. Where this particular sample was taken from is from the worst possible place to have taken it, number one. And they violated their own scientific protocol by not taking more than one sample from different places in the cloth. And the sample they took sort of disappeared, like they didn't keep a good chain of custody according to their own protocol. And so there are many, I think it's fair to say this, because we heard this when we were at the Shroud Center in Colorado. We heard this from Dr. Jackson himself, who believes that there was an agenda. Mm-hmm. These people wanted to disprove the authenticity of the flaw. But I'll let you speak about where it came from.
But Ray Rogers originally said that the carbon dating therefore proves it to have been a fake. And he obviously changed his mind.
Right, obviously.
Right, because all of a sudden, this particular woman in Pennsylvania, I believe, noticed by looking at the magnification of the samples that they had out there, what looked to be a splicing of the linen cloth with cotton. Why? Well, there were particular areas of the shroud that had been worn. I mean, because whenever the shroud would go on display, even these angels, all right, they wouldn't have messed up the shroud, but when it was time for it to be displayed, people would hold it. And where do you hold it? You hold it on the very top, you hold it on the corners. There's even evidence of the shroud having like little nail marks, you know. So okay, hey, let's just put it there and just kind of display it. So where was the cloth taken from? From the upper corner itself. It really could not have been a worse place for it to have been taken. In fact, in the meantime, what they've done is some of the ultraviolet studies of the cloth, that the ultraviolet gives a different color based on the material of the cloth. And when you get to this particular section, instead of it being a nice reddish, orangish, yellowish color. It's forest green. Yeah. You know, a little fifth grader right here at the school could have said, don't use that section. So the science of the carbon dating, fine, no problem. The science, no one is doubting that. It's good science. You take an organic material and you put it through all the things, and yeah, so you get a date. But if it's, if you're using 14th, 15th century cotton on a first century linen shroud, well, yeah, you're gonna get an accurate dating of that piece, but it's not representative of the rest of the shroud.
So, using some of the fiber samples that were taken from elsewhere on the claw, again, I mentioned the University of Padua has been very really at the forefront right now of some of the scientific work that's going on. They had determined from a 2013 study that was published using the fibers that they took from the areas, not that they took, but the Sturp took in 1978. They have been able to demonstrate that the claw dates to the first century. Plus or minus 200 years. So again, this is all in the process of still being peer reviewed, but there is a growing consensus about their work at Padua that this is a more accurate dating of the cloth itself. Okay, so we're really only left with two conclusions. This is either the burial cloth of Jesus Christ, with an image that's created. Dr. Jackson would explain it in a way that, but anyway, I can give you the sort of the Cliff Notes version, is that there's an intense burst of radiation, of light energy that's unlike anything known on this planet. As a matter of fact, when I looked at him in Colorado and I said, I want you to give it to me in like two sentences that a liberal artist can understand, he said, well, we would have to suspend the time-space continuum to create this kind of radiation. And I don't know what that means, but it really sounds impressive. I'm sharing it with you. But his point was, as I took it, that this cannot be reproduced in any laboratory today. And he's a nuclear physicist with the Air Force Academy, okay? So it's either that, or it is some kind of an ancient or medieval artwork. And if it is a medieval or an ancient artwork, and it's an icon of our Lord's passion, and that's really what it is intended to represent, I've sort of started thinking about the way I use the vocabulary. I'm not sure I want to call it a forgery, because if it were an artwork and it was truly to represent our Lord's passion, I'm not sure it's fair to call it a forgery. But what I'd love to know is the person who did it, how it was done, because we still can't recreate the image, how they could do it using processes that wouldn't be available for centuries, could not see the result of their work, in any way, it was not visible to them. How do you know you created a perfect anatomical image when you cannot see it? And why is this the only one of its kind? Who is this person? This is not a Michelangelo or a Leonardo da Vinci. This is somebody else. We need to know who they are, right? So.
And why do they only do one?
Exactly. Why is there only one artwork like this in the world? So it's got to be one of these two things. Does everybody agree? There are no other conclusions you can come up with.
Well, and that's why people like Barry Schwartz, who, you know, next week you will hear him say that he believes that this is the authentic burial shroud of Jesus of Nazareth. He will not say Jesus Christ. He will not say Jesus the Son of God. But he will say that this is the authentic. Why? Because the second part takes faith. First part is all about the science and what it says and everything that's encoded in here. And there are plenty of other scientists who basically say the same. We, of course, approach it from the standpoint of faith, which we obviously believe faith and reason are not opposed to each other. They help each other. It's not like, okay, I'm a person of faith, or so I need to just kind of pretend that all this science doesn't exist, or I'm a scientist and I have to check my Bible at the front before I come in. I mean, we believe that they're both together. Pope St. John Paul II wrote an encyclical called Fides et Ratio, Faith and Reason. And the very first line of it, it says, faith and reason are the wings that allow us to fly to the truth. Truth is created by God. I mean, God is true. I mean, and faith, obviously, is of God. The natural world is of God. So we're not afraid. And in fact, it was Pope Benedict, when he was Cardinal Ratzinger, because in 1978, the Pope, the 1978, August 6th, Pope, soon to be Saint Paul the VI, dies. My father happens to be right over here. We were on vacation in Florida, driving back, and we heard the news. I can still picture that station wagon. that Paul the VI died, and then I become a freshman right next door, a Jesuit, and just a month later we hear that Pope John Paul I dies. Yeah. And I told my parents that morning, and they're like, "No! You must be watching something from Pope Paul the VI." And I said, "No, it says Pope John Paul I." And then in October, we get Pope St. John Paul II. October is when the Shroud of Turin Research Project is going on over there. One of the people who's the constants here is Joseph Ratzinger, who becomes Benedict XVI. And he's the person who's in charge of the Congregation for the Doctrine of the Faith. And he says, let the scientists do what they do. You know, it's fine. It's not going to hurt us. It's not going to hurt us one bit. And in fact, science can't disprove the fact that this is not. Now, I will say this. Easter is around the corner, 3 weeks from today, which means what? We will be hearing something from the media every year at this time, and oftentimes at Christmas too. There will be something that will somehow, they're going to take something that's Christian and usually quite Catholic, and when it happens, just say, Father Peter is an unbelievable prophet. I don't know. I don't know what it's going to be. But like last year on Fox News, they said, okay, here are the 10 things that are, the 10, I don't think they use the word hoax, but it's something that was. And number three on the list was a Shroud of Turin.
Yes.
You know, so it's, yes. Why? Because right now, the Christians and Catholics are, you know, people love Lent, and we're ready for Easter and the celebration of it, and therefore this is the time that our faith is usually most quickly, readily attacked. So don't be surprised. Now, we still have some time. We want to be able to, wait, yeah, be finished. Wasn't that 24? No, she's not finished. Excuse me. Wait for the finale.
Just real quickly, I want to run through the rest of this. I if you came to my Shroud presentations last year, you heard a good bit of this, so I really am going to zoom through this. We actually have very good history, as I mentioned. There's two different competing theories about where the Shroud may have been from the time of the resurrection until 1204, when we know that it was in Constantinople. One of those historical routes may have taken it to Antioch. The other one may have taken it to Edessa in Asia Minor, in Turkey. And we have some good sources for this. The Acts of Pilate, incidentally, the Gospel of Nicodemus, y'all won't find that in your Bible. That is an extra-biblical, non-canonical gospel, Gnostic gospel, but as a historian, I can't disregard it because it says something about the age. I can use it as a historical document. I don't suggest you read it as scripture because it is not canonical. Did everybody hear me say that? And I'm on tape as having said that, right? that is a non-canonical work, but it is a source. And then we've got another source, of course, a great one from Eusebius of Caesarea, who was a historian to the Emperor Constantine. St. Athanasius, who was present at the First Council of Nicaea, left a sermon in which he mentions a cloth that bears the image of Jesus. So we know that there's some possible historical explanations for where the cloth was leading up to 1204. There are also some impressive artworks. The legends described in that, both Eusebius of Caesarea and in the Acts of Pilate, involves the cloth being taken to Edessa, to the king of Edessa, King Abgar, by St. Jude, that St. Jude took the cloth and healed the king of leprosy. And that is a story that is told in both of those sources. And it is also depicted in artwork. You see this icon? This is from 945, Mount Catherine's monastery at Mount Sinai. There is this 10th century icon that depicts that very story. Okay, so do y'all remember we talked about what the carbon 14 dating was? 1290 to 1360. Okay, so this well predates that. And some people have criticized this and said, well, this is only the face of Jesus. But remember that we know that the shroud was folded and kept in a reliquary. Okay? So it would have been folded in some way. That doesn't necessarily refute that this is the same cloth. This is really compelling, and you're going to hear in an upcoming podcast about this particular artwork, the Hungarian Prey Codex, which is 1192. So it predates the carbon 14 dating by 100 years. And you will note this very distinctive weave of the cloth, sort of zoomed in on it here. You note the weave? It's the exact weave of the Shroud of Turin, that 3-in-1 herringbone that I talked about being so unusual. This is depicted in an 1192 manuscript. You'll notice that the hands of Jesus are in the same way, only the four fingers of each hand are visible. But the most important thing that you see on the Hungarian Prey Codex, everybody see that I'm highlighting back here? Can y'all see those? Okay. Those are the so-called poker holes. We really don't like that description, but that's what everybody calls them. That when you fold the shroud, you fold it once and then you fold it again and then again, right? They perfectly align. And the current thinking among shroud scholars is that at some point this may have been used as a corporal on the altar for a Eucharist. And that somebody swinging the thurible got coals on it, because they are in the identical place. They line up perfectly. Okay, let me go back to that.
Right. I mean, how could these particular burn marks, so if it would have been folded, it would have been folded in such a way that you could still see the face of Jesus and right. The back of his head as well at the main part of the altar. Right. And of course, to this day, since the very beginning and to this day, we use linen cloth. We use everything is linen. And why might this not have been used for liturgical purposes? I know that I've gone around the altar and, you know, oops, you know, you hit, and some thurbles, all of a sudden, some of the charcoal might very well go out, and all of a sudden, what they do? You know, they create this burn mark, and it went all the way through. You can see where it's biggest, and then it gets lighter, because now we know where the what would have been on the bottom.
Right, the furthest away. What's so important about this particular codex, though, is that you see these burn, you see those little four holes right there? I would encourage you to look at this up close. This is very compelling. They are exactly like these four burn marks. So why in 1192 would a monk in Budapest, Hungary, be creating a manuscript, an illustrated manuscript, and depicting a shroud and a weave and the poker holes that he'd never seen? Think about that. Okay, so these missing years from 1204 to 1355 is what is particularly interesting right now. It's what I think it's fair to say that Father Peter and I are really interested in this 130. Well, you did the math. I was a liberal artist. 1204, 1305, really interested in those missing years, because if we can document the shroud being somewhere between 1204 and 1355, then it helps nullify that carbon 14 dating. Do you understand? History has the potential, actually, I'm very excited about this as a historian, has the potential to actually trump science. So I certainly contribute something that's very important. So,
and if you've heard the podcast, you know we're going to the Vatican. We're going into the Vatican secret archives. We've been given 3 days in which to research this particular topic right here. We're going to look at some of the documents of Pope Innocent III, who was the Pope at the time and who would have had access to anything he wanted on this planet, really.
Right.
Well, Western world. And so, yeah, we're hoping to find some information that might discount certain theories that are out there, which is good for history too. But.
Right. It's equally important. There's a couple of theories out there right now that are getting a lot of attention that, just as a historian, I feel like are a little bit spurious. I don't think that they're grounded in the actual history. And so to be able to eliminate those is going to be equally as important as anything we might find. But of course, we are going to find the answer.
The two of us right here.
You heard it here first.
That's right.
Okay, so yes, the shroud research does continue today and very, probably more intense than ever in the last 40 years, mostly because of an organization called the American Confraternity of the Holy Shroud. This is the sister organization you've heard us talk about if you've been listening to the podcast, the only authorized affiliate group of the Archconfraternity of Turin that have been the curators and custodians of the shroud since 1597. And Father Peter and I are both members. There's about 26 of us in the United States. And it is a group that is really dedicated to this particular object. And why, this is the last slide, why then are we so interested in the Man of the Shroud? I mean, obviously being approaching Holy Week and Easter, this is a great time to talk about it, but every single day is a great time to talk about this. And I'm going to turn the preaching over to you.
Well, it's because it's a great tool of evangelization. Right? I mean, what we have done here, yes, we're talking a lot about science, but there's so much more I want to talk about with regards to what we know in the Bible, and we're going to hear about that. Barry Schwartz is not afraid to quote Scripture, and we will hear more about the passion, what the Lord did for us, kind of like what I talked about at the very beginning. I mean, it just boggles the mind. There's so many other things that the Shroud tells us about, and we will definitely get into each of these topics more deeply. The podcast, what we do, as you see here, what we kind of take different things. So, for example, we talked about the bloodstains in this most recent one. So if you've heard it, it's all about the bloodstains. What does the blood actually say about the Man of the Shroud? The three-dimensional code coming up, the fires, et cetera, et cetera. So, and after about the fifth episode, we kind of really are just going to go straight into
right.
each topic. So the first five, we kind of, you know, we're trying to set, well, first of all, we're trying to, we're telling people about our credentials. We need people
right.
to know that this is like, we're really real here. We're not just
we're
kind
not
of
just
reading.
Doing this from our basement, you know, just broadcasting.
Exactly. So, and it's great because, a number of people in Rome know about this. We have at least one dinner set up.
With someone who's doing a lot of work.
And just as Pope Francis knew about the heart of St. John Berkman's coming here, remember we received the plenary indulgence opportunity for all who come. He knows about this work as well. I wrote him. So, and actually, he wrote back. Okay, his secretary wrote back. And so the morning of our first day in the Vatican Secret Archives, I will get to concelebrate with Pope Francis that morning mass in the chapel of Santa Marta. And I already have my speech prepared in Spanish when I see him. Hopefully, please, Lord, Dr. White will be in the back there, one of the in attendance at that mass. So what we're talking about is real stuff here, and we have even more to share with you. But you may have specific questions, you know, especially if you can put it in context of Barry Schwartz coming next week. If you have questions of photography, nature, wait for him. You know, he knows the ins and outs. But maybe you do have some type of a question right now. Yes?
Could you say something about what's known about Jewish men, how tall they were,
okay. yes.
and hair and face,
yes.
and how that comports with what's seen on the shroud?
The shroud tells us that this person is 5 foot 10 inches tall. Is that tall or small or normal?
Tall.
Back then, it is tall.
It is tall.
It is tall. So for some people, they're like, what? You know, first of all, I don't know where in the Bible it says that Jesus was
tall or short.
Tall or short or fat or whatever. I mean, you know.
He couldn't have been fat.
No, he couldn't have been. I agree with that. So it would have been taller than the average person from ancient Palestine. The hair, people clearly had longer hair. And this tells us that he had hair. And based on what is on the back here, it would have been like in a ponytail.
We know that he had a ponytail, a Jewish ponytail.
Hmm. You know, because of all of the blood that's coagulated there. And
you know, there's been a lot said about, and a lot of detractors have pointed out that he would have been too tall. That the man's shroud is too tall to have been Jesus because men were about 5'7", 5'8". That's average height. But there have been plenty of cemetery excavations done of the first century outside Jerusalem and found male skeletons that were 5'10", 5'11". So we know that it might be uncommon, but it's not unheard of. And I would also add to the detractors who say that he's too tall to be an ancient Jew, he's also too tall to be a medieval European. I would add that. He's too tall to be a medieval European. So, yeah. I mean, those are great questions. Those are great questions.
And another common question is, okay, so they looked in, they saw the burial cloths right there. So his body was probably stolen. You know, there's that theory out there. But let's also think that through. Would a person have gone and stolen, so taken the shroud off of him? Okay, let's just play this through. So your body, your lifeless body, is laying on a linen cloth. The blood, some of it is already coagulated when he's on the cross. But as soon as they take the nails out and they put him there, now blood is flowing. There's so you have multiple types of blood that's evident there. And so you're on there, it's pressed upon you, especially the back. If you were to take it off, I mean, imagine we would have all sorts of scabs and smearings and everything else of the blood, but that's not what we have here at all. Plus, what would you steal the body and kind of run with the naked body?
And not take the shroud.
And not take the shroud, or would you, I mean, that just is kind of, I think, logical. But at least from what the shroud says is that, no, the person somehow left the shroud.
And one of the things that Dr. Jackson, his current work has led him to a hypothesis called the fall-through hypothesis, which he'll be able to explain a lot better than I can when he's here this fall.
Well, In October. For the 40th anniversary.
For the 40th anniversary of STIRP, he will be here.
He's going to be in Shreveport, Louisiana. He's a nuclear physicist. And Barksdale has already been.
Yeah, Barksdale's involved.
We're going to get a couple of their nuclear people over here.
But he believes that what happened is that there is, as again I said, this time-space continuum suspended because Jesus assumes the ethereal body, the body that is transparent. And that the moment his body became transparent is when the shroud fell through his body. He didn't like rise out of it or rip it off.
Right.
It fell through him.
And actually, Mel Gibson kind of depicts it that way in the
Passion of the Christ,
that very last scene. All of a sudden, you just kind of see it poof, you know, just kind of falling through. That part is probably realistic. The scourging is not. That type of a scourge. In fact, Mel Gibson himself says, I intentionally wanted to drive people to the edge. And he even kind of uses that phrase. And he wants to elicit a faith response. So, yeah, anyone who would have been scourged with that type of a scourging would have really seriously died right then and there. Yes?
Wasn't there a light that emanated from him when he did the
transfiguration?
Yeah, wasn't it
right.
a brightness about him?
Absolutely, which no bleach could make whiter.
Right.
I mean, already with the transfiguration, we're already getting a glimpse of his glorified body, as it were. You know, I mean, he's in the air. I mean, that tells you something. Moses and Elijah are there. You know, they've been dead for centuries.
Right.
And so.
And remember when he entered the upper room, he walked through the wall, came through the doorway.
Right, the body is glorified.
Yeah.
Mary Magdalene is there and doesn't recognize him until he says, Mary, you know. And then she's like, ah, Rabboni. So, yes. Sure.
Absolutely. I think at that point it's fair to say he could have done anything.
And if this had been the force that we're talking about, if it had somehow been extended, you know, there would be some type of a major crater right there. I mean, we're talking about this is on the nuclear level. I mean,
right.
When we think of nuclear, we sometimes think of nuclear bomb and what happened there. But there was something of the supernatural order that happened, and we would say that. So why are scientists interested? You know, what's the mechanism? How is it that this image gets onto the shroud? So I mean, we haven't figured that out. But we do believe that something must have been so unbelievably great, supernatural, and this type force cannot be duplicated
anywhere in the world.
Anywhere. I mean, they're trying. They want it to be duplicated. They want it to.
Believe me, there's plenty of people out there who want to prove this can be done.
Right, but then how do you prove it can be done 2,000 years
right.
ago
or
in 1360
years ago,
or
right, exactly.
Whatever. Now, what we are going to do is formally conclude, but we can still take some more questions. It's 15 minutes before the 11 o'clock mass. There's so many other things. I want y'all are going to be super prepared for questions for Barry Schwartz. He's going to hear the way in which you speak about it and the verbiage that you have. And
can we add to that the Saturday morning event will be in the multi-room? And so please, if you know anyone who's interested or you think would benefit from this, please invite them. We have room. We're expecting a lot of people, but please invite them to come to that Saturday morning event. Okay? Thank you.